See, so far we have been discussing about problems in oral from oral text. Okay, we have been discussing things orally, and somebody is writing all those things. Okay, and we are arriving at the root cause. See, what if there is a graphical image which helps you to see all the problems in a single diagram? It will be easy, right? Just looking at the map. See, if somebody explains you the route to a particular place, how to reach Taj Mahal from Noida, you may take left, right. That is different. But if you got a map, you are able to visualize what is on the way and how to take where to take left, right, everything. So that is more a pleasant for the brain. That is how the human brain is created. Cognitive learning, we used to say it as cognitive learning. So this kind of diagrams will be easily understandable. Is easily understandable. And it has more impact on the people, okay, who analyze it. So we are going to see what is this cause and effect diagram, and when it can be used, and how it can be used, how to use it. See, actually, the cause and effect diagram has another two names. It can be called as a fishbone diagram. Okay, let us see. Some of you may have used it, but let us see why it is called as fishbone diagram. It is also called as Ishikawa diagram. It will help you to prioritize the possible causes, possible X factors, which is creating the problem. So we will see it with the help of a small example, so that easy for you to understand. Okay, so let us move to the cause and effect diagram. So these are some of the basic tools which have been used by the quality control people, manufacturing people for a long time, but it is effective. That is why it is still prevailing in the sector, in the manufacturing process or in the service process. So it helps you to identify many possible causes. In a single diagram, you are able to see all the possible causes for the problem. Okay, possible causes, probable causes. And it helps you to identify the source of variation of your process. Okay, and it sorts the process, it sorts the possible causes into different categories. Okay, in the brainstorming and the YY analysis, we are listing all the ideas. After that, the facilitator has to sort out things. But in this diagram, we are getting everything in a shorted manner. So it will be easy for us to understand and find out the probable root cause easily. See, it is also called as Ishikawa diagram after the creator of this particular diagram. So the cause and effect diagram is also called as fishbone diagram or Ishikawa diagram. Okay. So this is a graphical tool which records everything in a systematic manner and helps you to understand the probable root causes related with the problem easily. Now let us see the basic frame of a cause and effect diagram or fishbone diagram. See, first we have to write the problem or the cause on the right hand side, effect on the right hand side. Okay, then you have to draw a center line like a center bone of the fish. Then you have to write all the categories which are related with that particular problem. All the categories. Okay, it may be a process method, it may be raw materials or any materials. Then the measurement method used, then manpower involved, or the machineries, equipments involved, or the environment. So you have to write the problem on the right-hand side. Then you have to write all the categories that may be connected with that particular problem on the top and bottom of that particular line. Then you go ahead and find out the possible causes using brainstorming and YY analysis, whether the method may be wrong. Whether the small step followed inside the method may be wrong. You go ahead and do brainstorming, YY analysis, and write down all the possible causes under each category. So now it is easy for you to write, right? Easy for you to understand. That is, in the method, you may be having three, four possible causes. Under the materials, you may have three, four possible causes. Why there is a rejection? Because the raw material may be wrong. Okay, the raw material composition may be wrong. So likewise, you can keep on adding all the possible causes in each categories. Okay, under different categories. Sometimes you can write the sub causes for the main possible causes also. So likewise, you can construct a diagram. Okay, which will be looking like a fishbone structure. That is why it is called as a fishbone diagram. Let us see a small example. Okay, see. Let us took the same example which we have seen previously. That is, my friend was late to the work. See, what are the various factors, categories connected with that particular problem, the process, then equipment involved, materials, people, environment. See, what are the processes? Setting the alarm clock is a process, making breakfast is a process, traveling to the office in a particular route is a process, setting off time is a process, sharing the car is a process. Likewise, if you take the equipment which is involved in my friend's morning activity, car is involved, bread toaster is involved, coffee machine, hair dryer, alarm clock, then what are the raw materials involved? Milk is involved for making coffee, petrol is involved for driving the car, then electricity. Then if you take the people, manpower involved, family, wife is involved, children is involved, then the morning mood is also involved, people who destroy the mood is also involved, then my boss, okay, everybody is involved. Then car sharers, if they are late, if they are sick, that they are all, they can also be a reason, so they are also involved. Then another important thing, environment. Suppose if there is a heavy traffic, yeah, people who are traveling in the morning hours, they know. Suppose if they are getting continuously caught in 3 or 4 traffic signals, each signal, if it's taking 3 minutes, 12 minutes gone. So if you are there traveling in a neck-to-neck manner, they will be late for the office. So traffic signals, poor roads. Suppose if it is raining heavily, you cannot travel in a bike. So you have to stand off. Traffic lights. Suppose if there is a railway gate or a toll gate, because of that also may be a delay. So everything which may be, which can be, or which may be a cost of a 10% will be brought into the diagram. So now you've got a very clear understanding what may be the reason, what may be the probable cost factors, and whether it is under the process or whether it is under the equipment or whether it is under the materials or manpower or environment. You see, as per your organizational requirement, as per the problem, you can add number of categories. Okay, you can add marketing, you can add sales, you can add customer satisfaction, you can add quality control. Any categories can be added in this fishbone diagram as per your specific requirements. Okay, so now after analyzing all this, we are able to find that setting alarm clock is a problem. He set the alarm clock, but the alarm clock didn't work. So you may get a question whether 2 possible causes may be under 2 categories. Yes, here you can see alarm clock, setting of alarm clock is a process and alarm clock is a equipment. So this single possible cause is repeated under 2 categories. It is common. Okay, so it is allowed. So there is no hard and fast rule that you have to write 1 possible cause in under 1 category only. There is no hard and fast rule. You can write certain possible causes under 2 different categories also. So here you are able to identify that since alarm clock failed, it doesn't work properly, he was late to the work. So now you are able to identify all the possible causes that may be a reason for the particular problem, that may be a creator of that particular problem. So this is how a fishbone diagram will help us to find out causes, okay, in an elaborative but in a simple manner, in a more understandable manner. Okay, let us see another manufacturing like example connected with the thermal power plant. See, the problem is variation in steam generation. So in thermal power plants, we used to generate steam in the boilers. Okay, there is a continuous variation in the volume of steam generated. So what are the possible causes? It may be the fuel. It is a very simple cause and effect diagram. So don't think I have missed a lot of factors because the space is not sufficient. Okay, it may be the fuel or it may be the draft system. Okay, that is a pressure system which is involved in the boiler, or it may be the boiler water quality, or it may be the water itself. Okay, so if you look at the fuel, suppose if fuel has more moisture, then also it may not be able to provide sufficient calorific value. Suppose if fuel flow is non-uniform, suppose if the nature of fuel used, if it has more fibers, if it is not burning properly, suppose some other reason, suppose if you are using a sugarcane baggage as a fuel, suppose if the fuel content is more than the optimized one, increased sugar content, then also there is a possibility that the fuel may not be able to burn with more calorific value. And as a result of that, the various steam generation may vary. So likewise, the draft system, that is a pressure system. Suppose if the forced draft fan, the draft fan used to suck the air from the boiler and it used to create a vacuum inside the boiler. As a result of that, the temperature, the fuel will be burning inside there. There will be a continuous supply of air and the fuel will be able to burn easily. Suppose if the draft system is not working properly, then also there is a possibility that the calorific value, the heat inside the boiler may be less, and as a result of that, the steam generation may be less. So improper forced draft fan, suppose if the induced draft fan is not working, for example, SA fan, that is secondary air fan, if it is not working, then also there is a possibility for the draft system to work in a low performance manner. Then the water level, in the boiler drum, we have to maintain minimum water level. Suppose the water level is falling below the particular level, then also there is a possibility that the steam generation may not be up to the required quantity. Then boiler water quality. Suppose if the water circulated inside the boiler tubes, if it is having a lot of dissolved salts, if it is not purified properly, okay, if the temperature is varying in different tubes, if there is a pH value is varying, then also there is a possibility that the steam generation may be affected. Likewise, you can add more technical categories and the possible causes below it. Okay, this is just an example. We have more categories. We have actually 15 categories. I have cut it down short for the presentation. So this is how you can use the cause and effect diagram to understand the possible causes for any problem. So another important thing when you are using the possible, cause and effect diagram is, you can categorize this possible factors, cause factors, under four categories. Okay, that is, we used to call it as effective shorting. Okay, that is, for example, we have certain possible causes under high control and under low control. See, for example, can any one of you say, can you control the traffic?
No.
Gentlemen, can you control the traffic?
No.
So, in this case, under this particular category, this possible cause, you don't have control or you have very less control, like low control. That is, we used to call it as low control possible cause. Okay, another question. Whether you can control the setting of the alarm clock?
Yes.
So, you have high control. So likewise, you can categorize, you can short out the possible causes into low control and high control. Similarly, you can short out the impact of that possible causes into high impact and low impact. Okay. For example, applying brake is in your hands. You have high control over applying brake when you are driving a car. Okay, suppose if you are not applying the brake in right time, what is the outcome? It is going to be a disaster. The outcome is high impact, right? So even though you have high control over the brakes, if you fail to do it, the outcome will be a high impact. Okay, likewise, you can categorize the possible causes into low control possible cause and high control possible cause, and the outcome of the possible causes into high impact and low impact. So based on that, you have to give priority. That is prioritizing. As I told in the beginning itself, you can prioritize the possible causes. Okay, here you can see the one in the red has to be given more priority, more importance, because you have high control over that possible cause. Setting alarm clock is in my control. I can control it. If I want, I can throw the alarm clock, right? So I have full control over the alarm clock. So if I didn't use it properly, if I didn't control it properly, then the impact is I am going to get caught in the traffic police. So high impact. So I don't have any control over rain or traffic lights or bad weather, but still they can create a problem when I'm going to my office. The impact is high. So you have to give importance to the red first. Okay, then the green, then the blue, then the yellow, then the green. So likewise, you have to prioritize the causes. Okay, that will be easy for us to understand the entire cause and effect diagram. So within this short period, we have seen how to generate this, how to draw this cause and effect diagram, okay, and how to use it how to develop it and how to prioritize the causes, and you can find out which causes needs immediate action using the cause and effect charting diagram also. Okay, so I believe it is simple and easily understandable. If you have any doubts, you can ask. We are ready to answer.